What is the difference between a dog saying this, a child saying this, a person, student saying this, and a master saying that? A dog can see it as an object, it can just play with this. A baby also can do that, but there is a possibility for expansion of that maturity in future. And a student can know that it is a digital recorder, whereas a scholar can assemble and repair it. So these are the different levels of perception. So we perceive things without having the definition, without having the description of the structural and functional status of the element. So this is where we differ. So number one, knowledge is based on exposure. It may be pre-exposure, innate exposure, or post-exposure observation, number one. And rule number two, it is an additional perception. Apart from seeing it by your optical subjection, you are seeing it with this exemplification, with comparison, with novelism. If you see it now, it is novelism. If you compare it with somebody else or something else, that is comparison. So comparison, analysis, prudence, cognitive drill, mere perception, innumerable stages are there in knowledge. So any addition to your objective perception is known as knowledge. And the rule number three, whenever you want to gain knowledge apart from perception, you need two urges, two sparks. One is the intentional spark, second is the attentive spark. If you have the intention to get that, that intention creates an urge, it creates a pressure inside your mind. There is an endocosmic reticulum and exocosmic reticulum inside, known in shastras as Chidakasha and Mahatakasha. So the lateral space that is hidden inside the mind, that gives a pressurization when a person is interested in knowing about something, that is known as intentional pressure. That intentional pressure that occurs in the fraction of a microsecond or picosecond or nanosecond, that immediately generates attention. If it is coupled with attention as well as intention, immediately it tries to know about that. That trial is known as the first step or threshold of knowledge. So attention and intention, both of them contribute in understanding the nature, function, action, hyperaction, inaction, interaction, effect and impact of things between each other or with contrary elements. It may be homogeneity or heterogeneity in nature. So this is how the system or the tree of knowledge that expands. Then how that knowledge is processed inside? Very simple. Whenever you see something, immediately you reproject the same thing inside your mental stream by means of a process known as visualization. What is vision and visualization? And envision. Envision is to see something which is there before us. Visualization is to see something which we have seen. And vision is to see something which we are planning to see at the end of our action. So that is known as envision, visualization and vision. You are having vision and vision of life means you are seeing the end product. You are seeing the end product. Whenever you are seeing a product, its byproduct or repro product, whenever you are seeing the end product, the stages are known as envision, vision, and visualization. In this visualization, automatically the inner drill, by means of comparison, by means of other observations, by means of any auditive, olfactory, sensory, and various other applications held by itself or connected with somebody else, it develops a system known as conceptualization. The conceptualization gives two things. One is in the positive side known as a fact. The negative side it is known as illusion. Whenever we see things moving, whenever we observe motive elements, immediately we see that they are moving and we assume that there may be a pressure or an inner pressure known as life. Living things, they move. Plants, they don't move, but still they grow. In the methodology of the botanical system known as tropism, they used to grow. So we understand that. So whenever something is moving and not appearing to be moving, and whenever we appear even something to be very controversial or vice versa in our observation, it becomes illusion. Whenever something, because of the rules of physics, whenever something is mobile and something is immobile, the immobile status perception will be equivalently mobile with that of a mobile body which is parallel and adjacent, which may be seen in the train travel times. You might have experienced the same thing. That is known as automotive illusion. Like that, I don't know whether hundreds of knowledge systems are there or not, but thousands of illusions are there. Thousands of illusions are there with a few solutions. So, fact and illusion. Fact leads to eternal bliss in the form of wisdom. Fact is a spark, and the effulgent, radiant, brilliant fire is known as truth. And if truth becomes realized, that becomes wisdom. The wisdom, if it is shown towards the world, that is known as potence. And harmony, peace and prosperity is nothing but the blessing of the potence. So it starts with just a fact. It should be consolidated, it should be properly directed, they should be conglomerated to build hyperstructures, to create curvatures, to create lot of trust layers to form into the ultimate benefit, which is known as wisdom. So to start with, we have to start with only facts, and we have to recheck whether they are factual or fictional, whether they are fabricated or whether they are factually real, veritable in nature. Whether it is veritable or dutable should be checked by knowledge. According to Western system of knowledge, knowledge is not composite. The knowledge for gaining something is different from the knowledge with which you are going to check it. That is entirely different. They have different systems. Whereas we have only one composite wisdom, or a collective system of a compound wisdom, whereby everything is totally knowledge. Anudaya, samshaya, viparyaya, vismriti, vipralipsa rahita, nishkalankam, jnanam, jnanamitruchate, saeva dhihi. That knowledge which is inherently devoid of nescience, misapprehension, false apprehension, oblivion, and internal or external deception. That type of knowledge, which is very courageous, which is very dynamic, which is very turbulent and positively salubrious and torrential, that type of knowledge, what we call dhi, what we call medha, what we call prajna, what we call sevushi. Innumerable terminologies have been given in the Indian system of knowledge. Indian system of knowledge is a complete model, whereas Western knowledge is a beginning process by which completion is acquired by means of an access methodology, approach methodology, drilling methodology, introspective or extrospective methodology, by means of the process of empiricism and experimental analysis. This is the base between the Western and Eastern systems. Is a vast cleavage in which our system, even though we had something in abundance, now we have nothing except in the form of books. Even though they did not have anything, they processed. That's what I always used to compare with the story of a sleeping hare and a moving tortoise, in which who will win the race can be easily identified by people. Like that, we had a lot of things like that. Now coming to the Shastra's classification of different systems of wisdom, that is Mula Jnana, Vibhaga Jnana, Parichaya Jnana, Prayoga Jnana, Pariksha Jnana, Parishkara Jnana, innumerable jnanas. At least there will be 300 plus jnanas are there. For example, what is Mula Jnana? If I say it is water, I am saying that it is water. That is known as Parichaya Jnana. It is just acquaintance of this element by our early acquaintance. And secondly, Mula Jnana, how it has been formed? It is H2O. It is a combination of hydrogen and oxygen. It is known as Mula Jnana. Vibhaga Jnana, what are the different types of water levels and water status in the form of rivers, in the form of streams, ocean, and various other things, rainwater, groundwater, stagnate water, then moisture, then water in the form of various contents in the biological process. They are known as Vibhaga. Prayoga, how we can use water for purification and for drinking purpose, for washing purpose, for maintenance of our bodily system. Innumerable works are there for these things. So they are known as Prayoga Jnana. Then what is Pariksha Jnana? How to test it? And Parishkara Jnana, how to purify it? Prapti Jnana, how to acquire it? So innumerable things are there in Mula, Parichaya, Anvaya, Samanvaya, Vibhaga, Vibhajana, Avishkarana, Nutanotpatti, Sadhyotpatti, Jatotpatti, Vriddhi, Abhivriddhi, Samriddhi, Diksha, Ati Diksha, Ullanghana, Samyantrana, Niyantrana. These are all innumerable exercises. If you say water, then it has hydrostatistics, hydrodynamics, then oceanography, then hydrology, hydrometeorology, hydrobiology, hydrotherapy. Innumerable systems are evolved in the society. Like that, this is known as jnana, in which each and every dimensional status of an element is properly understood and developed. And let us start with, there are two instincts. One is the major instinct, which is there biologically. Second is the cognitive instinct. All of our inbuilt systems are governed by biological instinct. They are known as instinctive drive. And whatever we do by learning, whatever we do by hearing, speaking, discussion, debate, self-analysis, more observations,